Congress President Rahul Gandhi's assets. He's going to be taking the stage in just about 10 minutes from now. His assets have increased by 64% in the last 5 years. The poll affidavit filed by Rahul Gandhi in Wayanad, Kerala yesterday shows that Rahul's net worth has increased from 9.2 crore rupees in 2014 to 15.1 crore rupees in 2019. The steep increase in his immovable assets are primarily due to the office spaces he purchased in Gurugram on Delhi's outskirts that was worth 8.75 crore rupees. His movable assets, on the other hand, have decreased from 8.07 crore to 5.8 crore, a lion's share of which, that's 5.19 crore, is in mutual funds. The cash on hand, he's declared to be just 40,000 rupees. Okay, so Speech Analytica begins. We're in that last stretch before Rahul Gandhi arrives in his helicopter and takes the stage in Chandrapur for his big speech. I want to introduce once again our big panel. We've got Dr. Srijana Das Mitra. She heads Opinion at India Today Group Digital. Ajit Jha heads our research team. Balakrishna is part of our fantastic fact check team. We have Uday Mahurkar, senior editor. Anshuman Tiwari heads India Today Hindi. We have with us Nikhil Rampal of our Data Intelligence Unit, who's going to be looking at all the words and how many times they appear and giving us some empirical data on that when the speech begins. Rajiv Dubey, Managing Editor Business, and Javed Ansari, Senior Editor. Rajiv, I want to come to you now because, you know, job security, agrarian distress are likely to be very, very important highlights in the speech that's coming up. I mean, nobody needs to be an expert to say that since he's speaking in Chandrapur, it has to be tailored towards that. We're not going to hear much about the Rafale in that particular speech.
You know, this has been a continuing theme right through 2014, right? If we look at the 2014 manifesto, it talks of job creation, new job creation agenda, and things like that. And this time, the government, in fact, Rahul Gandhi has said that if his Congress comes to power, they'll actually create a ministry for employment.
Yeah.
These things have never worked, but I think he would like to keep the narrative fixed around Nyay and poverty, poor people, unemployment, economic, all the weak points as far as the BJP is concerned. And in contrast, if you see all the speeches that we are hearing from the Prime Minister, they are about nationalism, they are about anti-terrorism,
yes, very true,
and things like that. So it's very interesting how this is split in the middle between the economy and between nationalism and national security.
It's
really fascinating how this is starting to play out.
Hugely fascinating, and you know, there is such a it has become so stark. I mean, you don't need to be politically aware or politically active to see these two narrative threads. Anshumanji, how do you analyze this and how do you read this? Because on the one hand, you've got Mazboot Sarkar, yeah, and Boti Boti, and no other Sarkar can, you know, put Pakistan in its place. And on the other hand, you've got what Rahul Gandhi is doing.
Shiv, I think that Rahul has the best place to speak about rural distress, because Vidarbha has got over 2,500 farmers suicide, and those has been despite the loan waiver given by the Maharashtra government last year. And from the day one, since this manifesto came, the rural distress is the core theme of Congress, and where BJP is actually on the defensive, because rural distress is rising in Maharashtra. This region, which is Yavatmal, Chandrapur and Amravati, these three seats which have perennially prone to the farmer society. Secondly, the important part is that here Hansraj Ahir is seeking another round after three rounds, and there is a dispute inside the BJP there, because earlier the leader, which is the local leaders, are not with him, and the person who is against him has just recently switched from Shiv Sena to Congress.
Yes.
Congress. So this is a very interesting field from where Maharashtra is entering, and he can make a sort of major point about the rural distress, which probably BJP has to counter, or BJP leaders has to counter, when they reach to Maharashtra and Vidarbha region.
So you're basically saying that this is an area that is almost tailor-made for the kind of traction, yes, in the, you yeah know, what the Congress's yeah message is.
I agree with Rajiv and yes Anshuman, you know, but I have a slightly different take.
Yeah, yeah.
So on governance, he is basically relying on his delivery. You know, direct benefit transfer. I've been speaking to people at the lower level, you know. About 55 crore people have got payment through direct benefit transfer in more than one scheme. And then there's another thing called geotagging.
Yeah.
In the major schemes, they are monitored through geotagging. Mm. When a benefit is transferred to a person, his picture is taken, geotag picture, it is put on the app.
Okay.
So, I mean, he's basically relying on his good governance record, what he thinks, you know. I mean, I have tried to speak to him, to his people also, you know. He thinks that rural distress will be, to some extent, rather to a large extent, will be addressed by this delivery.
Okay.
His record of delivery.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So the record will speak for itself, you say, and that it may not be. So I'm coming to you, Javed. I just want to get the other guests in because they haven't had a chance to speak. Then you can respond directly. Ajit, sir, you've seen these two narratives playing out. Vidarbh, Chandrapur, pretty much like Anshumanji said, tailor-made for the kind of message that Rahul Gandhi has been harping on. Do you think that there could be anything different? Is there a temptation for the Congress to engage with what Narendra Modi is saying? Or are they seeing the dividends and sticking with the agrarian distress job creation narrative?
I think the Congress has decided to stick to Nyay, jobs, farmers issue. As Anshuman pointed out, Chandrapur is the appropriate place. It is right next to Garchiroli, which used to be a center of Naxalism in this country.
Yes.
Absolute tribal poverty. So it's the right place to sort of pitch oneself. Maharashtra is ruled by the BJP. In fact, the BJP seems to have an edge in Maharashtra. So I think they should stick to that, because the moment the Congress shifts its narrative, moves away from Nyay, jobs and farmers, it will start playing second fiddle to the Prime Minister.
Yeah.
Because the Prime Minister is very good in making his own pitch. He has done a complete sharp different pitch.
Yeah.
Achievements of his government, Hindutva nationalism, security. Lots of Pakistan bashing, right. So if Rahul Gandhi would end up switching, as he did in the past with the Rafael issue, I think he'll end up being a loser. It's better for him.
He might fall into a trap.
That's right. He should define. He should define a new narrative. He should define the agenda of this election. And the agenda should come from the left, as he is doing correctly right now.
Okay. Absolutely. Okay. Javed, you had a quick point for Uday. You wanted to respond to something?
No. It's one thing. While there's a lot of merit in what Uday says, if you notice what the Prime Minister, if you follow closely the Prime Minister's speeches, very little of what Uday is saying find mentions there. What comes uppermost to mind is hyper-nationalism, national security, then it's tukle, then it's boti, and like a clever campaigner, he tailors his campaign to suit the local landscape. But the main thrust of his speech is not on what he has delivered, or on how he's hammered Pakistan, how, you know, he's the only one, mazboot, who can save the nation.
Okay.
So he's trying to position himself as the Hercules who can solve all the who can take on the enemies.
Udayji, a quick
and
response.
Less
I want to bring Bala in also.
More
on
of
the
Nash.
Yeah. I think Congress has very little option now. It has to stick to Nyay, to agrarian distress.
Which they will. Yeah.
On national security front, I think after choosing Wayanad as a constituency, Congress has very little option. And if you look at the Pakistan channels, you know, which we get to see on Facebook off and on, you know.
Yeah.
The way the statements of Congress and other opposition leaders are being played up to buttress their own theory against India, you know, this creates a very dangerous situation.
Which is something that the BJP has been mentioning in rally after rally.
No, it's there.
Aap log hero ho, Pakistan mein, etc.
A very interesting thing that happened in Jammu. Jammu's speech.
The only time,
for the first time, in fact, you heard the Prime Minister actually admit that he has not fulfilled all the promises. He actually said that it was not possible to do it in 5 years if others haven't been able to do it in 70 years. So that was really, the highlight of that speech in Jammu.
Okay.
So that was very interesting.
Answering Javed, Shiv, basically he's relying on his governance record, you know.
Okay. What we're also going to do is I've asked our producers to cut some bits of today's speeches in Amroha and in Saharanpur, and we'll match them with Rahul Gandhi's speech so those two narrative threads become very, very clear. Just one second, Anshumanji, I'm going to come to you right now, and I want to bring Bala in as well. But I'm told that we have a fresh chat with Smriti Irani, who is the hopeful from Amethi against Rahul Gandhi. I just want to quickly play out a bit of that, then we'll bring in Anshuman and Bala.
Thanks for watching the video. For more such news and updates, please like, share and subscribe to India Today. Also check out our other great videos from our channel. We know you will love to.